gadgets and pause. A very special, special welcome to you if you were one of our families or friends joining for the baptisms or the confirmations tonight. A special welcome to you. Or if you're returning after Easter, welcome. Hey, I'm going to give you 30 seconds to just quickly say hello to someone around you that you haven't said hello to yet. Welcome them to church. It's amazing. Amazing, amazing. Well, we have a tradition of starting our service by singing praises to the God that we believe in. So why don't you join us in being encouraged by the people singing around you, and let's worship our God together. Let's sing. We won't fear the battle.
We won't fear the battle. We won't fear the night. We will walk the valley with you by our side.
Now and forever, He is my light. I stand in
church. We're so happy that you're here. We're about to sing a song that is really encouraging and has really encouraged me throughout the week. It's got a lot of beautiful things in it, but there's one verse in particular that has been super important to me this week, and I wonder if it would encourage you as much as it has me. It says, "Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, the first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art." I don't know what circumstance you've come from this week into this building. I'm sure there is a massive array of people here. I don't know what your week looked like, but maybe it was not the best week. Maybe it was. Maybe you put your hope in something, your faith in something that failed, that didn't come through when you needed it to. But as Christians, we have a joy in the gospel that we have hope and that we have inheritance in something that is unshakable, something that will not fade, something that will not fail, and that is God, God above. So I pray that as we sing this song, you would reflect on that truth, that we do have a hope that is true, that is firm, that is a rock in times of trouble. Would you be encouraged as we sing? Would you dwell on that truth together?
Save that though.
for all that you have done for us. We thank you for Christ, who through his life and his death and his resurrection purchases us freedom from sin and allows us to have an eternal relationship with you. Lord God, as we gather together tonight to celebrate these baptisms and these confirmations and to hear your word preached, would you grow us in our knowledge and love of you, that we may serve you all the days of our lives. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, friends, it's so good to be with you for church tonight. My name's Ben. Can I invite you to grab a seat? Could you squish in as well so we can try and fit as many people in the room as we can, and then welcome those around you as you do that. If you are sitting out in the pavilion, we have 5 seats up in the front row here. If you want a front row seat, feel free to come on in and join us. There may be some others as people are squishing around. Well, it is so good to hear those conversations, and I encourage you to continue them at the end of our service. Well, what a night it is to be gathered together tonight for our baptisms and our confirmations. We're going to come to that segment in just a short while. But if it is your first time with us here tonight, maybe you stumbled in and you're wondering why I'm wearing slides and boardies and we have a massive tank of water up the front of church. Well, we're so glad that you've joined us for church tonight. You've joined us for a very special service where a number of our members here at St. Paul's are getting baptized or confirmed, which is a very exciting time. But if it is your first time here with us, either visiting St. Paul's or coming here in support of one of our baptizands or confirmees, we would love it if you could get plugged in and connected with us here at St. Paul's. So why don't you head to stpauls.church/connect and fill in your details, and a member of our staff will be in touch with you this week to talk you through some next steps in getting plugged in with us here at St. Paul's. We also have a welcome desk up the back where you can head after the service to meet one of our staff and to get integrated with us here. We have a welcome pack that we would love to give you with a whole heap of exciting things in there that you don't want to miss out on. So if you are joining us for the first time, or if you're feeling new, please do head up to our welcome desk after the service. Now, we have mentioned that this is a very exciting service because it's our baptism and confirmation service. And so I'm going to now invite our Bishop Chris Edwards up onto the platform along with all of our baptizands and confirmees. Can we make them feel welcome?
Am I on? Do I need to flick? There we are. There's a few people, as everybody comes up onto the stage, there's a few people I'd really like to acknowledge. The first are the people who work tirelessly behind the scenes to make things run here smoothly. And because they're behind the scenes, often they're invisible and overlooked. Let's not do that. The techo people have put things together brilliantly for tonight. I turned up last minute, gave them something else. They've stuck it in. Can we just thank them and acknowledge them, the hard work? I always feel sorry for the technical people, because if they do their job brilliantly, no one notices. They just go, yeah, that was right, yeah. But so thank you for doing that. But there's also a group of people sitting outside in the overflow. Hey guys, welcome. We're so glad that you are here, and we hope you can hear everything and it's all going okay out there. Well, let's welcome them too. Baptism and confirmation is a really exciting time in the life of any church, because it's a moment when we pause to reflect on what God has been doing in people's lives, in calling them to himself. This is not about what these people have decided and done. It's really confusing, because I'm going to ask them some questions about decisions that they've made. But that's not the main thing. And it's really important to keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing is that God has been at work in their lives and has called them to himself. And as a mark of that, that they've entered into and joined his family, the church, there's a couple of things we do. One is the sign of baptism. And the sign of baptism is effective. It's a wonderful thing. People say to me, well, it's just a symbol, isn't it? And I go, well, no, it's a bit more than that. Think of it like this. A traffic light, the green light, is a symbol. If you look at a green light, what does it mean? Very good. You could probably get a license based on that. It's go. But what is there in that that says go? There's nothing. It's just a green light. We've just all agreed that that symbolizes go, which is very different to a sign. If you come to one of those yellow signs that has a train on it, a picture of a train, you know that a train is coming. That's a sign. The green light is a symbol. What we're celebrating tonight is a sign that God is at work in their lives. In the lives of my brothers and sisters who are here right behind me, God is at work, changing them, transforming them, and it's all happening because he has a plan for them. That's something to celebrate. Now, with baptism, the sign of water is a great sign that shows that sins can be washed away, that there is a new life that's being celebrated, being born again. Confirmation, we do that because it's right, I think, to baptize young people, young children, even when they can't answer for themselves. But tonight is an opportunity for the people who were baptized when they were young to confirm the promises that were made. Interestingly, what I'm going to ask the people being baptized and those being confirmed are exactly the same questions. Because the people being confirmed are confirming the promises that were made. The people being baptized are making the promises tonight before you all. So, without further ado, let me ask them those questions. Do you turn to Christ? Do you repent of your sins? Do you reject selfish living and all that is false and unjust? Did you hear that? They're serious promises. What they're saying is they want to turn to Jesus and follow him, and they want to reject the way of this world. Let's encourage them. Let's all stand together. We're going to say the creed together. We're going to recite it. It'll be on the screen. It's just a reminder to everybody in this place of what it is we believe. Together, we believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please take a seat again. Now, there's a prayer we're going to pray together. We do this because we want to recognize together and before God the work that he is doing. Would you join me in this prayer? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that in your great love, you have called us to know you and to trust you. Increase this knowledge and strengthen our faith. Grant these people what they cannot have by nature, that being born again by the Holy Spirit, they may be cleansed from all sin and inherit your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thanks, Ben.
Okay.
As our baptizands and confirmees go to grab a seat, we thought it would be worth talking through some practicals of what our night tonight is going to look like. So we're going to start with our baptisms first before the sermon. After we go through a time of prayer and the Bible is read, Chris is then going to open God's Word, and then we're going to do our confirmations afterwards. And some practicals for you guys. As each baptizand is getting into the water, you may notice that they're bringing someone in with them. The person who's getting in with them is someone who has played a significant part in their walk with Jesus, someone who has had a significant influence in their life and who God has used graciously as a significant figure in helping them to grow in their knowledge and love of Jesus. And also practically, they just help Holly and I to actually baptize people. We wouldn't really be able to do it by ourselves. Two other things. First of all, if you are friends or family of the person getting baptized, then Holly, myself, and Keith as well will invite you to stand. This is a sign of solidarity with the baptizand, the person getting baptized, as a way to say you're close friends with them, you're family with them, and you support them as they're getting baptized as well. So if you are close friends and family of our baptizands, when Holly, myself, or Keith invite you to stand, please be upstanding. And finally, as our baptizands come up out of the water, as we finish baptizing them, we would love it if all of you could go crazy and cheer and celebrate. We want baptisms to be a celebration. As Chris mentioned, it's a sign of the powerful work that God has done in each and every one of our baptizands. And so we want to celebrate that. It's heeding a command by Jesus in Matthew 28. So we do really want to celebrate the baptism of each one of our baptizands. So as they come up, it would be great if you could erupt and clap and cheer and just celebrate that time as well. Getting into baptisms. In baptism, we use ordinary water to point to the extraordinary work of God in cleansing us from sin and giving us a new heart to trust and serve Him through the death and resurrection of His Son. Baptism provides a public opportunity to turn to Christ and express a personal trust in Him and what He has done for us, and to ask for the renewing work of the Holy Spirit. So with that in mind, I'm going to hand over to Holly and our first baptizand, Tilly.
If you are family and friends of Matilda, why don't you stand up? Matilda, why did you tell us, why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to get baptized to publicly show my relationship with Christ and what He has done for my life.
Awesome. Well, Matilda, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Elaine, why don't you stand up? And Elaine, why do you want to get baptized today?
Because I want to publicly declare my faith and love for Jesus and show everyone how good my God is.
Great. Well, Elaine, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. If you're family and friends of Mia, why don't you stand up? And Mia, why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to get baptized because I love Jesus and He loves me, and I want to share outwardly what He's done in my life.
Amazing. Let's just move forward. May I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Family and friends of Georgie, I invite you to stand. And Georgie, why do you want to get baptized today?
Because God has been so good to me and I want to show that he has got full control of my life.
Georgie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You to stand. And Venice, why don't you tell us, why do you want to get baptized today?
Because I want to publicly display what God has done for me and be made new again in him.
Awesome. Let's Venice, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son. Oh, you didn't go under. We're going to do it again. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'm going to pass over to Ben now, who's going to continue in our baptism service.
Okay, our next baptizand is Oregon, so if your friends and family of Oregon, please be upstanding. And Oregon, why do you want to get baptized today?
Because I want to publicly show that I'm committed to Christ because of what he's done for me.
Ready? Oregon, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Our next baptizand is Hayden. So we're currently fundraising for new stairs for the baptism tank. So if you are, it's been a long time coming, I think. If your friends and family of Hayden, please be upstanding. And Hayden, why do you want to get baptized today?
Because Jesus means everything to me and I want to show outwardly the love Jesus has shown me.
Awesome. Step forward. Okay, Hayden, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Our next baptizand is Elliot. Friends and family of Elliot, if you could be upstanding. And Elliot, why do you want to get baptized today?
To declare my life to Christ and to show outwardly how he's changed my life.
Elliot, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
We're going to baptize Bethan. So friends and family of Bethan, would you please stand? So, Bethan, why do you want to get baptized tonight?
I've been a Christian for a long time, probably far longer than I need to be, and it's time. It's time for me to make that public commitment to God and to His church.
Fantastic. All right, let's do this. I've coached her. Bethan, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Can we thank all our baptized Ends one last time? Praise God for the amazing work He's done here. And Jeff is going to lead us in prayer.
Begin with a moment of reflection to acknowledge our failures before God and His willingness to forgive us. O Lord, you know us better than we know ourselves. As we come before you now, believers and doubters alike, we all share a deep need, for we are lost without your grace. Search us, O God, and know our hearts. Test us and know our troubled thoughts. Give us true repentance. Forgive us our wrongs. Transform us by your Spirit to live for you and to learn to serve each other and to come at last to your eternal kingdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful Lord, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. On this Sunday each month, we pray for the persecuted church around the world. The prayer will appear on the screen. I invite you to join with me as we pray. Almighty and most loving God, the Father of all mercies and God of all consolation, whose compassion never fails, save your persecuted people. As they pass through the waters of adversity, may the rivers not overwhelm them. As they walk through the fires of affliction, may the flames not consume them. Give them your aid, for they are needy, your strength, for they are helpless, your hope, for they are in despair, your deliverance, for they are in danger. O God, make them firm in their faith, make them joyful through hope, fill them with your love. Protect them from the wiles of the devil and the conspiracies of men, so that, passing through the waters, they may come at last to the land of everlasting life, there to reign with you forever. In the name of the all-powerful and triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Gracious God, we are aware that many in our state are struggling with the current inundation of floodwaters. Thank you for all who have worked so hard in recent days to protect the lives of men, women, children and livestock, especially all emergency services and the volunteers with the SES. We pray for those who've lost lives in the earthquake in Thailand and for families of those still missing. We pray, God, you would bring an end to the conflicts in Gaza and Ukraine. Our hearts are heavy with the needless loss of life, livelihood and income. We pray especially for the family of aid worker Zomi Frankham and her colleagues from World Central Kitchen who were killed recently in Gaza. Bring comfort and relief amidst the depth of their pain and anguish. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for calling us to know you, trust you and serve you. Grant to all who have today publicly declared their intention to turn to Christ, determination and energy, wisdom and grace to continue to follow you until their life's end. Protect them from the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil. Pour upon them the continual dew of your blessing, that their lives might bear witness to the transforming love of God as they are shaped by Jesus and strengthened by your Spirit. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Finally, we give you thanks for our Bishop Chris, for his energy, enthusiasm, love of people and your word. As he brings your word to us a moment, may you speak to him and through him that we may be blessed, encouraged and strengthened. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, good evening, church. I have the joy of reading from the Bible for you this evening, and tonight's Bible reading comes from John chapter 21, starting at verse 1 through to 14, and then verse 25. I'll just give you a moment to find that in the Bible now. So John chapter 1. John chapter 21, starting at verse 1. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat. But that night, they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come back and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. And then verse 25. Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful piece of artwork, isn't it? That reminds us that Jesus quite often used that title of himself, I am. It doesn't sound like a title. If you are using it in a sense of yourself, it's really just a way of referring to you. I am Chris. I am a father. I'm a grandfather. But when Jesus used that phrase, I am, he was actually making a very profound statement about himself, that he is divine. It's actually the name of God. I am. I am who I am. I am who I will be, who I will be. I am. Jesus' claim through John's gospel is that he is God. He is light. He is truth. He is the way. He is the resurrection and the life. He is the good shepherd. He is the vine. Jesus is the one. And here we are in John chapter 21, the last chapter in John's gospel. And if you've got a Bible with you, I invite you to open it up. If you can see it on your phone, I invite you to have a look. If you look at anything else, I won't know. God will. Have a look. You'll see that John's gospel could have ended in chapter 20. The way that chapter 20 ends is a really, really neat conclusion. It's almost like if I was Steven Spielberg or a movie maker, if I was one of the Coen brothers, well, I wouldn't be one of the Coen brothers, but if I was a movie maker, then I could have finished at chapter 20. There's a really good line there. But John doesn't finish at chapter 20. He keeps going into chapter 21. And that's no accident. For he wants us to know something about Jesus, who is I am. And it's not just a coincidence that this chapter 21 is in its place. I wonder, what brought you here tonight? Was it to hear John 21? I wonder what brought you here tonight. Is it because you're getting baptized, or maybe you're getting confirmed and that's why you're here tonight? Or maybe this is your church family and you're just here because this is home. Maybe you're here to be here with someone who's being baptized or converted. Maybe you just stumbled in and you're here for the first time. That's fantastic. Whatever reason, that is really wonderful. But you know what? You're not here by coincidence. You're not here by coincidence. You know what a coincidence is, don't you? Here's a definition I found. A coincidence is a remarkable alignment of events or circumstances without apparent causal connection. What that's saying in a fancy way is a coincidence is like an accident. It just happens. You know, it's just things come together. There's no rhyme or reason to it. And I want to say that no one is here tonight by coincidence. John 21 is not put on by coincidence. You might think it's a coincidence. I get that. That's okay. I don't want to make a big thing of it. But John chapter 21 has a number of things in it that could look like coincidences. Let's have a look at John 21. You see, there's an incredible sting in the tale and the definition of a coincidence, that there is no apparent causal connection, which means it's an accident. These things just randomly happen. Yet I believe that God has his hand on all things. You being here tonight is no accident. So let's see what it is we're here to hear. Let's go back to John 21, the passage that was read. Thank you, Steph. We find seven disciples and they're back in their boats. They have been with Jesus Christ for 3 years. They have been following him, living with him. They've been eating with him, listening to his every word. They have been serving him. They've been going out on missions for him in his name. They have seen him heal people. They have seen him change the course of nature, or even use the water as a footpath. They have witnessed all of this, but they've also seen him arrested. They've seen him beaten. The one they thought was going to be the king of Israel, a prisoner to the Romans. The one they thought would be the Messiah that would save everyone, didn't even take himself off the cross to save himself, but instead died. They saw it. Then he was buried. They saw that. Then it gets really confusing. Because on the Sunday after the Friday, the tomb is empty. And so they race to the tomb. Some of these ones who are in their boats, they race to the tomb to see what had happened because they've been told that the tomb was empty. So they go and the tomb is empty. You would immediately think grave robbers. Except the women who got there before them had said to them, no. Angels met us. They said the Lord has risen as he said he would. They were scared. They got back together again. They were in a room together. And we don't know what the conversation was, but I imagine it was, can you believe what you've heard? Can you believe that he's alive? And he appeared. He came and he was with them. He spoke with them. He ate with them. Now, they weren't all there that night. Thomas wasn't. The one who's named as Didymus in the version you heard read, which means the twin. So Thomas wasn't there, and you know Thomas is famous for having his doubts. And so Thomas, I'm not going to believe unless I can put my fingers in his hands where the nails went. Unless I can put my hand in his side, I'm not going to believe it's him. Then Jesus appeared again and said, Thomas, see the scars? Put your fingers in. And all he said was, my Lord and my God. They are confused. They don't know what's happening because then Jesus is no longer with them. What do you make of all this? What do you do when confusion overwhelms you? What do you do when it's not clear because there's no one to lead the way and all that's happening is completely, totally unexpected? What do? You go back to what you know. That's what you do, don't you? You go back to the things you understand, the things you're familiar with. So they go back to working as fishermen. They go back to the jobs they had before they got called by Jesus. They go back, in fact, to the very place where they were when Jesus called them. They were not wealthy. They lived in poverty. In fact, I understand that according to some estimations, 9 out of 10 people in Galilee live close to subsistence level or below it, because their poverty was so great. We know from Acts that Peter and John, who are mentioned in here, they had no silver or gold. He told a beggar as much when they were in Jerusalem. They're poor. They don't have their leader. They don't know what to do, so they go back to fishing. For the last 3 years, they've been living off the generosity of people who loved and followed their rabbi, Jesus. People would give money to Jesus and his friends. They'd feed them. They'd give them accommodation. They'd look after them. For 3 years, they've been doing that. And they've lost their businesses. They've lost their boats. They've lost any income, any revenue. And now that's gone. He's gone. What do you do? In total confusion, they go back to fishing. I find it really striking that some of the disciples who are named here, when our Lord first called them, we're doing exactly this. And here it is for the last time that we see Jesus in the gospel. Here they are doing the same thing in the same place. I don't think that's a coincidence. Did you pick the coincidence? Let's look at some of them. At the beginning of his earthly ministry and the end of his earthly ministry, Jesus finds these men fishing. Listen to Mark chapter 1. I'll read it to you. It should come up on the screen. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, who's called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake. They were fishermen. Come follow me. When he'd gone a little further, he saw James and John, the sons of Zebedee, in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them. They left their father Zebedee in the boat, and with the hired men, they followed him. I wonder if Peter, James, and John were picking up on the coincidence that's happening right now. They're back in the same place that they were when Jesus first called them. They're doing exactly the same thing they were doing before when Jesus called them. I wonder if they notice that little bookend, that little coincidence. Do you think they noticed? I wouldn't be surprised if they did, especially when you look at Luke's account. Let's have a look at what Luke says. When Jesus had finished speaking, he said to Simon Peter, put out into the deep water and let the nets down for a catch. Simon said, Master, we've worked hard all night and we haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I'll let the nets down. When they'd done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in another boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw this, he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they'd taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. How could they miss this coincidence? Because that's just what's happened again in John 21. Not only are they in the same place where they were when Jesus called them, fishing, doing the same job, there's a miraculous catch of fish. Back in Luke chapter 5, right at the beginning of their ministry, they get told to go out and pull in the nets because Jesus said so. Here they are in John 21, and it's exactly the same. We've been out all night, we haven't caught anything. Jesus says, throw your nets on the other side, and they haul in a massive catch. Actually, they can't haul it in. How could you miss the coincidence? Jesus again at the Sea of Galilee, Jesus again telling them to throw their nets in. How could they forget that? They've caught nothing, nada, zip, nothing. Then a teacher arrives, catch some fish, not even a fisherman, and they catch such a bounty that it's beyond what they can carry. How could they ever forget that first event? How could they ever miss the second event? How could you ever forget? You wouldn't, would you? 33 years ago, I went fishing on Sydney Harbour with a mate of mine who had two very important things for fishing, a boat and a fish finder. And we went into Sydney Harbour, and with his fish finder, we could see where the fish were. We caught so many, we had three eskies full of fish in a very short period of time. I'm not a fisherman. In fact, all I've ever done before is thrown a line in and then looked at water. That's all I've ever done. Until this day, we went out, and I can tell you, I remember it. 33 years ago that happened, and I still remember it. These men are on the Sea of Galilee. It's only 3 years since the miraculous catch, and here's another miraculous catch. Do you think that's a coincidence that John is saying, look what happened? Look what happened? But that's not the only coincidence. How could they forget all of that? Well, could they? Did they notice what's going on here? Here at the end of his ministry, he does what he does at the beginning. Did they notice it? Did you notice what's going on? When Steph was reading the Bible, did you notice? Gee, I've heard that before. That's similar to something before. Gee, that's a coincidence. Did you notice that? Let me confess something. I hadn't until I started preparing for tonight. And then I started seeing all these things that are just repetitions of what happened in the gospel earlier, what happened in Jesus' ministry, what happened in their lives earlier. Let's have a look, because there's another moment, an incredible moment. They couldn't have forgotten this one. It comes from John chapter 6, verse 5. And it's a miracle. I'm sure you've heard of it. Let me read it to you. Jesus looked up. He saw a great crowd coming toward him. And he said to Philip, where will we buy bread for these people to eat? He asked this only to test him because he already had in mind what he was going to do. And Philip answered, it would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, he spoke up. There's a boy with five small barley loaves and two small fish. But how will they go far amongst so many? And Jesus said, have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass in the place. They sat down. And Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. Have you heard that story before? Did you notice? Did you notice it's bread and it's fish? Do you think they would forget that? No. Of course they'd remember it. Did you notice what was on the menu when they got off their boats to come and eat breakfast that morning? Bread and fish on the Sea of Galilee. Join the dots. This is no coincidence. This is Jesus making clear to his disciples, remember when I called you? You were fishermen. What are you doing? Remember when I called you? I said, go gather people. What are you doing? Collecting fish. Do you remember when I fed 5,000 people with bread and fish? Come and have some bread and fish, because do you know who I am? Do you remember what I said on that day? Let me read to you what he said on that day. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life. Do not work for food that spoils, but work for what endures to eternal life. Don't gather fish that will go rotten in a day. Go and gather people. Let them know who I am. People who will last to eternity. Do you think they could miss all these coincidences? Do you think they missed the coincidence? There's a miraculous sign of bread and fish given. Do you think they missed the menu? How could you miss it? Especially when the 5,000 were fed, guess how many baskets of food were left over? 12. Guess how many disciples there were? 12. Now, I don't know, because the Bible doesn't say, but I love to use my imagination at this point. I reckon each one of them got a show bag that day. Enough bread and fish so they would remember one each, guys. Don't forget, you don't work for this, you work for what is eternal. And here they were on the Sea of Galilee working for what would go rotten in a day. So Jesus reminds them. Jesus shows them exactly who he is. They couldn't miss it, could they? Did you miss it? When we were reading this through, connecting the breakfast with the miracle of feeding 5,000? Did you miss who Jesus is? See, that's why I think John has put this in. At chapter 21. Because he's given us all we need to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God, and by believing we can have life in his name. But now he says, now don't forget it. And don't forget what he calls you to. And don't forget what purpose he has given. And don't forget who he is. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the resurrection and the life. He is the vine. He is the good shepherd. He is the Son of God. There's so many coincidences in this passage, but there's one more I want to point out to you. And you probably wouldn't have picked this up from the translations that we have in English. But it's to do with the fire that was burning. You see, when they come ashore, Jesus has a fire burning and he's cooking fish, which is interesting, isn't it? He's already got fish. They don't need to bring the fish in. He's got fish to feed them with. The fire that's burning, it's mentioned that it is a coal fire. Did you notice that when we heard it read? This expression for a coal fire is only mentioned twice in the Bible. Here, on the beach, and in a courtyard in Jerusalem. The courtyard in Jerusalem, that fire was burning the night before Jesus was crucified. In that courtyard, Peter wanted to see what was happening. And when people saw him as he approached the coal fire there, they said, you knew him, you were one of his friends. No, I don't know who he is. They said, hey, you've got a Galilean accent. Of course you know him. No, I don't, never seen him before, don't know him. Three times he denied knowing Jesus in front of a coal fire. And now there's a coal fire burning on the beach. Do you think that's a coincidence? That is Jesus reminding Peter of what has happened. But what comes in chapter 21 is a brilliant passage, because what it shows is that Jesus restores Peter. Jesus gives him a role that is so significant. It's to care for those who are in God's flock. Jesus is saying to all the disciples, yes, I realize it's confusing. Don't be confused. Listen to my words. Do as I tell you. If I say put the net over, put the net over. If I tell you to go and make disciples, go and make disciples. If I say to go to all the nations and teach them and baptize them and bring them in, then do that. Go. And these men, seven scared disciples and others, did exactly as Jesus said. And if they didn't, we wouldn't be here tonight. We would never have heard. But because they understood what God had done in their life, they obeyed Jesus. Because they understood that they were saved, they lived in a new way. Tonight we're celebrating that people have come to believe. Well, that's the end of chapter 20. Now we're in chapter 21. And for those who are being baptized and those who are being confirmed, and for all of you who believe in Jesus, now listen to this. It is no coincidence you are here. It is no coincidence you have heard God's word read. It is no coincidence that you've joined in prayer and praise of God. And what we are to do together is to continue to encourage one another and to let people know about the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the great I am, who is the resurrection and the life, who is the good shepherd, who knows you by name. We're to let people know of his love, his forgiveness, and his salvation. And we're not to let that go. That is what John 21 is about. So now what? We go and do likewise. But it's scary and it's hard. We need encouragement. We need help. God promises to give us all that we need. And one of the great things that we celebrate when we celebrate baptism and confirmation is that we are not alone. Can I invite the people being confirmed to come up now onto the stage with me? We are not alone. It is no coincidence that you're here tonight. It is no coincidence that these people are coming before us. God has been involved in their lives and will be. So I think what's a great opportunity for us as a church to do is to pray for them, to encourage them, and to remind them that just as much as they are a part of us, we're a part with them. This is a wonderful partnership. In fact, that's why they wheeled out old bishops like me to do this bit. It's to show that St. Paul's is actually not on its own either. St. Paul's, you're part of a much bigger family here in Sydney, a fellowship of churches and organisations right across the region of Sydney, right across the country. It's bigger than just us. Is that not a coincidence? No, it's nothing like a coincidence. So let's pray for these people. I want to ask Isaac and Max to come forward and stand. Isaac on one side, Max on the other, as I pray for you. And as Ben did, if you're here with Isaac or Max, would you please stand as I pray for them so that we might encourage them? Let's pray. Defend, Father, Isaac and Max with your heavenly grace. Guard them, keep them. May they always follow Jesus to the very end of their life. Amen. Thanks, guys. And now, Jasmine and Kayla. Let's keep doing that, yeah? And you know what to do now. If you're here with Jasmine or Kayla, please stand so we can encourage them and pray. Let's pray. Defend, O Lord, your servants Jasmine and Kayla with your heavenly grace. We pray that they would continue yours forever, and that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit each day until they come to your eternal kingdom. Amen. And forgive me, Kayla Jane. Charlize and Olivia. Yeah, you know what to do. Let's stand. Let's pray for Charlize and Olivia. Defend, Lord, your servants Charlize and your servant Olivia. Defend them with your heavenly grace. We pray for them now. We want them to walk in the footsteps of Jesus all their life. So please fill them with your Holy Spirit now and forever, so that they may be indeed disciples of Jesus. Amen. Thanks, guys. Rebecca and Eve. Let's pray. Defend, O Lord, your servants Rebecca and Eve with your heavenly grace. We pray they would continue yours forever, and so we ask, fill them with your Spirit until they come to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. And Manning and Adia. You guys could have just stayed standing up all the time. Let's pray. Defend, O Lord, your servant Manning and your servant Adia with your heavenly grace. We pray for them. We thank you for them. We ask that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit each day, more and more, until they come to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Thanks, guys. Now, here's something. I've been a bishop for about 10 years, and I've noticed that with nearly everybody I've confirmed, as I put my hand on their head, that there's quite a bit of shaking going on. Because it takes quite a bit to stand up in front of a crowd like this and to say that they turn to Christ, they repent of their sins, they want to give away the ways of this world and follow Jesus. It takes a lot. And so I would like you now to encourage them by, let's do it loudly, shall we? Yeah. There is an incredible privilege being in God's family. And one of the great privileges we have, which you may not have noticed, is that the Lord gave us a prayer to pray. We call it the Lord's Prayer, but it really is the disciples' prayer. We're going to say it now together. So that we might come before God in humility and confess to him that we've sinned and we need help. And also to ask him to lead us in a way that would be pleasing to him. So let's pray these words, which are familiar, the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We're going to sing together again of the goodness of God. How can we respond any other way after what we've seen tonight? So please stand and let's sing together.
has been together tonight, celebrating the amazing work of God in the lives of so many of our members here at St. Paul's. As we finish our time together tonight, I'd love to leave you with these words from the end of the book of Jude. It says, "To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore." Amen, amen. It's been so good together with you all tonight. We would love to see you up the back at our welcome desk. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday. Have a wonderful week walking with Jesus.